had his own life story that was not like the other. And I wonder, I was never given any pictures of this story. I wonder what they look like. What does this friend, less friend, look like? What does that less friend look like? I'm sure you can tell one less friend from the other if you saw them. So, what traits have you inherited, even if someone else has your name? What have you inherited from your family members that makes you unique? Do you have somebody's eyes? Have you been told that? Do you have somebody's nose? Do you have somebody something that you wish you didn't have? Some people do. Do you have a certain shape like another family member? Do you sound like your mom or your dad or your grandparents? Sometimes I'm just sure I am channeling my parents. Something I never said I would do. How about the way you act? I'm a careful planner like my dad, and I like to sometimes talk to people that don't know me, like my mom does. And if you look at pictures of my family, you'll see the resemblance through the ages. There might be somebody else out there with my name. I'm sure with Facebook you find this out. There are. I didn't think there was anybody else, but there is. And one of them might have even been born on the same day as me. But he doesn't look like me. And he doesn't sound like me. And he doesn't act like me. And he doesn't have the same life story as me. He just has my name. Or I have his. I like to think he has my name. But who knows? And so today we're going to read the name. I always start to choke up a little bit when we read the names. I can't practice it enough to fix that. These are our people. Each one is unique. Each one has her own life story. There might be another person with the same name. There probably is, but these are the ones who belong to First United Methodist Church of Champaign and have entered into the fullness of eternal life since last All Saints Day. Some of you might be their spouse. Some of you will be their children or maybe their sibling. Some of you call them friends. And you knew them. You knew them well. You really knew what they were like. You knew the sound of their voice without seeing them. You knew what they loved to do without asking them. You knew their funny little quirks. You knew. You knew what they meant to First United Methodist Church. You knew what they did. You knew. You knew what made them unique and special, unlike any other person in the world ever has been or ever will be. And these saints are in great measure our inheritance. They are our inheritance. Who they were, quite uniquely, is what they left here in this world with us. Imagine just a minute if we read every name of every member ever, all the way back to the very beginning, 160 years worth of First United Methodist Church members. That'd be quite a list. That'd go on probably longer, even though you got the extra hours. You don't want to stay here that long. But what if you heard it? My God, what a list. It's going to be amazing. What a gift. What an inheritance. And we look like them. We look like these. I'm not talking about their noses. I'm talking about who they were. We look like them. I think we'll always look like them. No matter what changes come, no matter if we do this and we don't do that anymore, we're still First United Methodist Church of Champaign. We'll always look like these saints. How many churches are named First United Methodist Church? How many might even have been founded in the same year as this one? But we'll never look just like any other one of them because of these saints, because of these people, because of who they were, these beloved ones who left their imprint on us forever and forever and forever. In his book, Words for Life, the English theologian and philosopher Austin Farrer said, "The commemoration of all saints is not concerned with those who lived particularly holy lives on earth, but with those whom the power of God has remade and brought through to heaven. To believe in the real existence of this great company is not to believe in something called the soul, which cannot die. It is to believe in God, and in God's will to save us alive and bring us near himself." Austin Farr says, if we want to know what God is doing with us, we look at these splendid beings who share the spontaneity of the Creator's mind, the delight of his heart, and the breath of his life. So the writer to the Ephesians says this, he says, in Christ we also obtain an inheritance. And the opening verses prior to our reading, verses 1 through 10, if you read those, you'll find they are absolutely packed with good news about what God's done for us. They are just packed full of good news. God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing, chosen us before the foundation of the world, destined us for adoption as his children, freely bestowed grace upon us, redeemed us, forgiven us, made known to us the mystery of his will to gather up all things in Christ, things in heaven and things on earth. 10 verses, all that's in there. 10 verses, and I want to know where else are you going to find all that good news in one place. You won't find it. And the writer prays that you and I will know the hope of it and the wealth of it and the glory of it and the immeasurable greatness of it. In essence, that we will know the richness of the inheritance that we receive because of the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The good news. The good news that God loves every person and wants every person and has gone to the furthest height and depth and breadth and length to have every person of every name and every place and every time, even the same names, no matter how many of them, blessing us with every spiritual blessing, forgiving us, adopting us, choosing us. This is what the church has for people that nobody else has. This is what we've been given that nobody else can give us. So what will we do with that? What will you do with your inheritance? That's the question. When you get an inheritance, you're going to want to open that envelope up. Take it out and see what's in there. We, the church, are the body that's received this gift to spend. To spend. And we want to spend what the saints have given us. We want to spend it. We want to share it. We want to spend the gift of God's grace and peace and kindness and generosity and forgiveness and love. We want to share it. We want to keep all that to ourselves. In essence, we want to look like Christ. The very same way that we look like the saints. People on the list today. The very same way that we look like our families. We want to look like the giver. We want to sound like Christ. We want to be shaped like Christ. When people look at us, when they look at the church, you want them to see Christ. We do not want them. I don't want them. I don't want them to see this violent, unforgiving, self-centered world. I want them to see the difference. I want them to see something different. I want them to be able to tell the difference, just like you can tell this lesson, Brandon, from that one. We want to go and fill this world with the very same grace and the very same kindness and the very same love and the very same mercy, the very same self-forgetfulness and generosity with which we are being filled. In fact, the writer to the Ephesians tells us that we, the church, are the body, Jesus' body, Christ's body, the fullness of Him who fills all in all. We are being filled up with God's love. God wants to fill the world with love through you and me and all of us together. God wants us to take this inheritance and to share it with the whole world. So here again would be these words of Scripture, these powerful words, as Eugene Peterson has translated them. It is in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, He had His eye on us, had designs on us for glorious living, part of the overall purpose He is working out in everything and everyone. It is in Christ that you, once you heard the truth and believed it, this message of your salvation, found yourselves home free, signed, sealed, and delivered by the Holy Spirit. This signet from God is the first installment on what's coming, a reminder that we will get everything God has planned for us, a praising and glorious life. That's why when I heard of the solid trust you have in the Master Jesus and your outpouring of love to all the followers of Jesus, I couldn't stop thanking God for you. Every time I pray, I think of you and give thanks. But I do more than that. Thank. I ask the God of our Master Jesus Christ, the God of glory, to make you intelligent and discerning in knowing Him personally, your eyes focused and clear so that you can see exactly what it is He's calling you to do. Grasp the immensity of this glorious way of life He has for His followers. Oh, the utter extravagance of His work in us who trust in Him. Endless energy, boundless strength. All this energy issues from Christ. God raised Him from death and set Him on a throne in deep heaven, in charge of running the universe. Everything from galaxies to governments. No name and no power exempt. And not just for the time being, but forever. He is in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body, in which He speaks and acts, by which He fills everything with His presence. Amen. So in this holy moment, we recall the names, we read the names. These members of our congregation who have died in the last 12 months. For all the saints who from their labors rest, who lead by faith before the world, Thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Hear with me now these names. Nita Proctor. Shirley Wiggle. Wanda Mitchell. Silva Walker. Jim Mills. Roy Jean Johnson. Elizabeth Libby Bolton. Mary Jones. Jean Kirby. Barbara Huffman. Wilson Zarin. Ruth Brucko. James Brad. Dorothy Brad. Martha Curtis. Russell Durbin. Eileen Foyle. Frank Fernhardt.